Palm Sunday for 2021, and here we are at Yale Presbyterian Church. We've gathered again, but not in the way we usually do. You're at home, probably, or somewhere else rather than in the sanctuary while we celebrate worship one more time under our pandemic restrictions. I'm glad you are here, and it's my hope and prayer that you will find this time to be meaningful and spiritual for you, even if it cannot be that fellowship time where we're all together. I bet you all have memories of the palm parades that we would hold on Palm Sunday with these leaves and the palms as we'd wave, as we sing, as we go into the sanctuary and things like that. Great images, great memories, and things that will come back. But for this year, we are not there. For this year, we have our restrictions and we will abide by them because it is a good thing to do, to keep us all safe and healthy and to minimize the amount of time that we have to put up with these restrictions under the pandemic. But here we are now for worship, and I'm going to open up this worship using the words, familiar words for Palm and or Passion Sunday, excerpts from Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness that I may enter through them, and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, but he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. And then continuing into this worship, opening up with that great Palm Sunday hymn, number 218 in our hymn book, but the words are on the screen. Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Come, let us worship. We gather in a time of prayer. Let us pray. God of all people and all places, God of all situations and all times, you are the light of the minds that know you, and the strength of those who serve you in times of challenge and times of joy. We come to worship you this day, setting aside our work and responsibilities, our relaxation and pastimes, to listen to your voice and reflect on the wisdom and courage that we witness in Jesus. As tension mounts for him and us moving into this Holy Week, we turn to you for hope and healing, for courage and compassion, in the name of Christ our Lord. Hear us now as we speak to you the truth about our lives. God of compassion, we confess that we prefer the darkness to your light and our ways to yours. We do what is easy rather than what is right. We have been dishonest with ourselves and each other. Forgive our fleeting enthusiasms and our shallow commitments as we witness again the story of Jesus confronting his enemies. Strengthen our desire to follow him and serve you with courage like his. Hear our prayer. Make us good through your forgiveness, and make this day good for us and your creation. Amen. In the Gospel of John, Jesus' words are recorded. He says, "I do not call you servants any longer, but I've called you friends. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." Dear friends, Christ has laid down his life for us and invites us to love one another as he has loved us. Rejoice in this redeeming love and share it with each other day by day. We continue in our Lenten tradition of the Lenten candles, and this week the liturgy is being led by my family, Anne and David and myself.
Jerusalem, at last, we join the crowd streaming to the mountain. We watch Jesus approach on a lowly donkey. We hear the crowd's cry, "Hosanna!
Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven."
There is a joyful song in the air. The people cheer and the palms wave, but the adulation of the crowd is shallow.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna to the blessed of God. Son of David, save us now.
The crowd grows. The people want to be part of something important.
Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Let us pray. God of all times, we have followed Jesus into the crowded city. We too want to catch a glimpse of Jesus. Reveal to us what true glory, leadership, and obedience look like under your reign. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. And as we journey further toward Good Friday, another light goes out.
Today's story is called The Story of the Easter Robin, and it is found in our church library. What's the matter with her gran? Teresa and her grandmother had watched two robins carry twigs, cat hair, and string to build a nest on Gran's window ledge. Now the bird wiggled, tail twitching, while its red-orange breast rose and fell. "That's Mama's just molding her nest for a good fit," Gran answered. But Teresa worried. It was still 2 weeks until Easter. A million things could go wrong when a robin tried to nest this early. The next day, Teresa ran straight to Gran's after school. Gran showed her the surprise. In the center of the nest laid one perfect egg, the color of spring sky. The father robin sat on a branch nearby, guarding his family. Teresa spotted raccoon tracks below and a blue jay eyeing the nest. "Gran, how are we going to keep the egg safe?" "We'll have to leave that one to the creator," Gran said. Over the next 3 days, the robin laid three more eggs. Teresa watched the mother robin nudge her eggs before huddling onto them again. "Turning her eggs keeps them from freezing," Gran explained. "See that bare spot on her red breast? God made her so she could warm her babies through that broad patch." Teresa hoped that would be enough. The day before Easter, a cold snap hit. Frost laced the window pane and whitened the nest. "Now the eggs will never hatch, Gran," Teresa cried. "We'll have to trust the one who watches the sparrows and robins," Gran said. "Now come with me. It's about time we see to some other eggs." Gran got some eggs from her refrigerator. She poked tiny holes in the top and the bottom of each egg. Then she blew the gooey insides into a bowl, leaving the shells in one piece. "I'll show you how to make oyster foggles. Easter birds. It's an old Pennsylvania Dutch I learned from my granny." Teresa blew half-heartedly on her egg. All she could think about were the real eggs outside in the cold. Gran dipped her eggs into blue-tinted water. When she lifted the shell from the dye, it was a robin's egg blue. Teresa knew Gran, and God, cared as much about those tiny robins as she did. And Gran wasn't worried. Teresa tried blowing out her egg again. This time it worked. Gran grinned over at her. "Since we have robins on our minds, how would you like to hear the legend behind the robin's red breast?" Teresa dipped her egg into the dye while Gran began her story. Around 2,000 years ago, a plain brown robin was flying over Jerusalem when he heard angry shouts from the street below. Swooping down to see what the fuss was about, he caught sight of a man, beaten, bent, under the weight of a wooden cross. "I know this man," thought the robin. "All Earth's creatures, except humans, recognize Jesus, the Creator God come to Earth." At first, the robin thought he saw a nest on Jesus' head. But when he soared closer, he understood. The nest was a cruel crown of thorns. "I must help the Master," thought the robin. But what could he do? Jesus stumbled as a whip snapped. He fell and the thorny crown dug into his head. The robin, filled with compassion, flew at the crown and tried to knock it off Jesus' head. But the crown wouldn't budge. It was then that the robin noticed one long thorn sticking into Jesus' forehead. The bird gathered its strength, grabbed the thorn in its beak, and tugged. The thorn gave away, and as it came out, a drop of Jesus' blood fell onto the robin's breast, staining it red from that day to this. Ever since, Gran said, the robin's red breast reminds us of Christ's sacrifice and how much he cares. The robin's song is the first sign of spring, helping us remember that after Christ died, he rose again on that first Easter. Teresa insisted they color the rest of the eggs robin blue's egg blue. Gran taught her how to cut wings, heads, and tails from the Easter birds they hang from the trees in the morning. When Teresa woke up the Easter morning, she ran to Gran's to hang her Easter birds. As she tiptoed beneath the robin's nest, something crunched under her shoe. Jagged chips of blue shell laid scattered over the ground. "Gran," she cried as she burst into the house, "the eggs, they're broken." Gran called Teresa up to her room. "Take a look." Under the mother robin's wings sat four scrawny baby robins, eyes closed and mouths wide open. "They're alive," Teresa explained. She watched the daddy robin drop bits of food into the baby's mouths. "God takes care of his creatures," Gran whispered. Through the window pane, Teresa could see the robin's red breast, bright against the sunshine. She was sorry she ever doubted God's care. From then on, whenever she saw a robin or felt worried, she thought of the legend, and she remembered all Jesus went through on that first Easter. "Thank you," she prayed, "for the robins and for Jesus." Outside, the wind howled, but the robin's joyful chirping came through loud and true. To Teresa, it sounded just like they were wishing her a happy Easter. She answered them, "Happy Easter to you too."
In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. From the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 12 to 16. The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming from Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written of him and had been done to him. May God bless these readings from his holy word.
I see the King of glory.
I made a New Year's resolution that I would always give 105% at work. I would give 12% on Monday, 18% on Tuesday, 35% on Wednesday, 25% on Thursday, 10% on Friday, 5% on Saturday. Sundays are really my day off, and I only volunteer whatever I do on Sundays. Is it not a disappointment that the Lord has created only so many days in a week for us to get things done? We look at that Genesis story that Jeanette read for us this morning. The first verses of our Holy Scriptures that talk about God creating the days. And He uses 7 days for that creation, and so we use 7 days for what it takes for us to get things done, whether that's 100% or 105%. And then a lot of those days we take and we set them off as special days. The whole of creation has had, I'm certainly, millions and millions of days. Each one of us in our lifetime have had a few thousand days. And a lot of these days we say are going to be a special one. Most of them, I'm sure we say, are just a normal day. Same old, same old. But then every now and then we say, hey, this is my birthday and it's going to be celebrated. This is an anniversary and it's going to be celebrated. This is a remembrance day of some sort. And certainly the church, and all religions for that matter, are very good at taking specific holy days, holidays, and making something special about them. Palm Sunday is one of those days that our church likes to set aside as something special. The beginning of Holy Week, Palm Sunday, moving through to Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and then Easter, that whole length of time where we make note of Jesus' actions and last actions before His crucifixion. But then we make it even more special by not ending it on the Friday, but saying, Sunday, hallelujah. Easter. Palm Sunday, if everybody was here, if we had our sanctuary full, if we had our Sunday school and our children, we'd have that waving of the palm branches, the singing of the Hosanna coming in to the sanctuary. And we make that a special day to mark that this is us entering into Palm Sunday. And I would always have a small little talk with the children up here at the front about what is special about Palm Sunday and what is special about the week between Palm Sunday and Easter. We do make this day special because so much of our faith expression is tied up in what happened a long, long time ago. The scripture's telling us that Jesus Christ entered into Jerusalem for that fateful week, and He was greeted by the exultant crowd, waving the branches and laying down the cloaks on the road and cheering, Hosanna, blessed is He who comes in the name of the Lord. And I love that image of Hosanna and waving of branches. We bring that up every time we do communion here because inserted into that liturgy is that little ditty song that we sing. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Let's make this Sunday a true celebration, a true worship of our Lord and Savior. But there's a problem with that. Because 2,000 years later, of course, we cannot put aside the fact that we know that this good day for celebration in memory of Christ's exultant entry into Jerusalem is followed up with a week of horror. We know what happened once He was there. And I wonder if we feel ourselves a bit fickle to have this day of celebration, to follow it up with that day of horror on Good Friday. What are we about as we take our emotions up and down through the remembrances of the things long past? We are about reconciling what it really means to be Christian. It is not all a rose garden to be a follower of Christ. There is a great message of hope and peace in the gospel. There is also an important message of suffering, loss, and sacrifice. And unless we acknowledge both sides of this coin, we do not have an honest grasp of our faith. This day of celebration cannot be understood without the inclusion of the day of sacrifice, Good Friday. But Good Friday, in turn, is not grasped by Christians without the inclusion of the Easter experience. It's great to have this day and to worship in it, but how can we enjoy and participate in this worship and be honest about our understanding of the whole Easter event? We often use that term for us Christians. We are an Easter people. We never say we're a Good Friday people. We acknowledge that Good Friday happened, and we hold a special service on Good Friday to acknowledge that Good Friday happened, but we never do that without in the back of our minds knowing that it doesn't end there. Cross and death do never have the final word. Easter, resurrection, new life are what God is about. For me, it's important to take this tangled time to reflect on the story, to reflect upon the juxtaposition of joy and newness and spring and suffering and loss and cross. Make this a spiritual week, an introspective week, a holy week of days that include the memory of a terrible, terrible event, but ends in a glorious hallelujah. Because as much as such a practice is a memory of a long ago event, it is also our story of here and now. It is our story of this whole past year, where we have lost so much, where we have suffered, where we have been restricted, where we have been anxious and worried and concerned. But entering into this week, there's that hope and there's that assurance, and there are good things happening as more and more of our community are being vaccinated and restrictions are being lifted, and we're opening back up into a good spring and a good summer at a good pace, being careful, doing things right, so that this time of loss and restriction and anxiety can be minimized and we can open back up to the glorious hallelujah things that we love to do in church, in family, and in our community. There are ways for you to continue on this journey this week. We'll gather again for a Tuesday table on our YouTube channel, the Lenten Communion. There will be a Good Friday service up on our YouTube channel on Friday morning. And then, of course, getting back together, because Easter is what it's all about. Go from this sanctuary today into the lives and the vocations that God has called us to. Go in a sense of worship and praise, and make this holy week truly holy by journeying in worship, returning to join together throughout the week, and culminate this worship on Easter, the day that only the Lord could make, a glorious hallelujah. Amen. Thank you. come together again in words of prayer. During this prayer, there will be some times of silence while I place some of our prayer yarn on the tree here. And those are times where you too can participate in your own silent reflection and prayer. Let us pray. Creator, Redeemer, you made the world in beauty, yet often it is filled with the ugly realities. We trust that you are at work in all situations, restoring and renewing all things. On this day, we find the courage of Jesus, inspiring, so that we pray that those in need will find such courage too, as your gift to make a difference in the challenges that they face. Hear us as we bring to you our concerns and send your redeeming power to touch our lives and your world once more. Wherever people are oppressed by the power of poverty, sickness, or grief, ease their pain and restore them to wholeness. Wherever people challenge regimes or systems marked by tyranny and brutality, encourage them with your spirit and lead them to liberty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Wherever people are burdened by the weight of hostility, greed, or jealousy, restore their strength to resist and show them signs of hope. Wherever people are persecuted because of race or creed, or for the truth that they tell, let your truth and justice prevail. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Wherever the earth cries out because people consume too much and ignore the danger signs, wherever care for the ground and water, for endangered climate and endangered species defies human carelessness, let your love for the goodness of creation move the hearts of your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church in every place, whether it be fragile or strong, tired or energized. Inspire us with your Holy Spirit to offer ourselves in gratitude for the gift of Jesus Christ, serving creatively and courageously in his name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us as we pray to you for the situations close to our own hearts. We know of a particular family close to our congregation and our fellowship who is having to say goodbye to a brother who has passed away. In your grace and love, restore all things. And then, Lord, hear the prayers of all of your people as we use those words that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Remembering the ways that God has been gracious to us and has gifted us with such bounty and such grace, then we return those things. We think about the things that we have been able to do this week, this month, all of our lives that have been good for other people, be that the donation of our money, the offering of our time, the presence of our spirit to other people. Remember those good things that we have been to others. Give thanks to God that we are able to do that. We join in singing our doxology as we rejoice in the things we are able to give. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It is he who calls us out from this time of worship now to go to other things, to our family, to our friends, to our communities, and to take that gospel news. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us go from this time knowing that we go with the love of God, the grace and the forgiveness of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit surrounding us always. Amen.